We'll now have our scripture reading by the primary class.
Remember that the Lord your God is the only God, and that he is faithful. He will keep his covenant and show his constant love to 1,000 generations of those who love him and obey his commands. Deuteronomy 7, verse 9.
So Titus, right? Where is Titus? Titus, right? So now we'll start with our sermons, and the first one will be by Titus, right? And we had a cancellation, so he stepped up to the plate. He only had 1 week to practice, so. Can you hold the mic, or do you want to put it up?
How good are you at telling people apart? Can you recognize someone you love just by the sound of their voice? How about only by touch? Close your eyes tight and feel your own hands. Are they different than another person's hands? Do they have anything unique about them? Are your fingers longer or shorter? Is your hand rough or smooth? Do you have any scars or bumps? How long are your nails? What do the lines on the front of your hand feel like? Can you feel your fingerprints? That's how Jacob's and Esau's father Isaac used to tell his two sons apart as he lost his vision and that and many of his other senses, so he would ask them to come up to him and he would feel their hands, arms, and neck. Esau was hairy and Jacob was smooth. It was tradition back then for a father to bless his son's old age before he died. The time of that blessing was coming closer, but Jacob knew that Esau was Isaac's favorite son, and it was very possible that Esau would get the bigger blessing, so he and their mother, Rebecca, came up with a plan that were going to trick his father into thinking that he was Esau. Let's have our volunteers come up. We're going to have some grown-ups line up here in front. Let's see if our volunteers can recognize their family members by feeling their hands.
Okay, so I'd like Pastor Harris to come to the front, please. Stuart Gautier, are you here? Come to the front, please. Is he here? I don't see him. Okay, Faith, would you please come to the front? Faith, please come to the front. And Sally, please come to the front. And Ruth, would you please come to the front? Ruth, yes. And Linda Taylor, please come to the front. And Zach, please. please come to the front? Okay, so I'm going to blindfold Zach, and he's going to try to guess which one of you is his mother. So,
No, you can't look. You got to look.
So, we see it's not easy when you're blind, right? Okay, so, where's the...
I'm going to read this whole page.
Okay.
Thanks so much, everyone, all for your help. That activity was hard, with no tricks at all, but... Imagine how hard that it would be if someone pretending to be the person you were trying to find. That's what happened to Isaac, as his eldest son Esau would go hunting and cook his favorite meal before his blessing. While Esau was away, the mother Rebecca helped their youngest son, Jacob, dress in his brother's clothing. She cooked the meal Isaac asked for and put ram's hair on his arms, neck. Jacob came to his father, but Isaac didn't realize it was him. He tasted the food easing. Would have prepared, smelled Esau's clothes, and felt what he thought was on the hair of Esau's hands. So he blessed Jacob, thinking it was Esau. And it wasn't until Esau came later that he realized what happened. You can read that in Genesis 27, verse 30 through 36. Now it came as soon as Isaac finished blessing Jacob and his brother Esau came from his hunting. He also made a delicious meal and brought it to his father and said to his father, "Let my father arise and eat of his son game, that you may bless me." His father Isaac said to him, "Who are you?" And he said, "I am your son, your firstborn Esau." And then Isaac trembled voluntarily and said, Who then was he who hunted game and brought it to me, so that I ate from all of it before you came and blessed him?" Both Isaac and Esau went bitterly, for they knew that Jacob had lied to him. he had stolen what that wasn't his. What a terrible day that must have been for the entire family. Isaac had to face the consequences of his actions. He broken his father's heart and betrayed his brother. His mother had to send him away. She told him, "Stay with your uncle for a while to give your brother time to cool his anger." Sadly, Jacob never saw his mother or father again. They died before he could return. Jacob left his family broken and brokenhearted. But Jacob's story doesn't end in this sad place. God was about to do a mighty work in Jacob's life. He was about to reveal Jacob how he would continue to remain faithful to his promises.
Good job. Thank you. Our next presenter would be Caleb Asante. And Joshua, please come up. Joshua.
In order to get safely to his uncle Laban's home, Jacob had to travel almost 500 miles through dangerous lands that had wild animals, robbers, and rough terrain. He left so quickly that he didn't even have a pillow to lay down his head. The Bible tells us that when he was finally able to rest, he was so tired that he used a stone as a pillow. How did you feel?
Not good.
A stone pillow is definitely not comfortable, but it was all Jacob had at the time. That night, God gave Jacob a special dream of a ladder. This ladder was so tall that it went from earth all the way to heaven. On that ladder, there were angels coming up and going down. God spoke to Jacob in that dream. Let's look at what God said in Genesis 28, verse 13 and 15. The Lord said, "I am the Lord, the God of Abraham, your grandfather, and I am the God of Isaac. I will give you and your descendants the land on which you are now sleeping. I am with you, and I will protect you everywhere you go, and I will bring you back to this land. I will not leave you until I have done what I promised you." Jacob knew when he woke up that God had been with him. This is what Jacob said: "The Lord is here. He is in this place, and I didn't even know it." Jacob wanted to remember this promise from his dream, so he took the stone he had used as a pillow, stood it up on its end like a pillar, and poured olive oil on the top as an offering. Given all of the events that had passed, Jacob likely had a lot of thinking to do on this journey. Jacob must have been feeling very anxious about his situation, but God stepped in to reassure Jacob that he was still with him. First, he reminded Jacob that he was the same God his father Isaac and grandfather Abraham had worshipped. Then he gave Jacob the same covenant promise he had given to his father and grandfather. You and your family will be my people, and I will be your God. I will bless you and be with you. God was revealing to Jacob something that happens all the time. Despite anything we might do, God will be always at work, making a way for us to stay connected with him. Although Jacob didn't deserve it, God sent him a special message of encouragement directly from him. This reassurance is good news to us who may find ourselves making mistakes or going through times that are scary. God had promised to be faithful to those who follow him. He reaches out, he forgives us, provides for us, and sustains us.
Jacob went to live with his uncle Laban for 20 long years. He agreed to work for him as a shepherd, but Laban kept changing the roles. First, he agreed to allow Jacob to marry his youngest daughter, Rachel. If he worked for 7 years. Those 7 years passed. Laban tricked Jacob, telling him that his eldest daughter, Leah, had to be married first. Then he asked Jacob to work another 7 years to marry Rachel. Jacob's family continued to grow. Before long, he had 13 children. Jacob saw that God was blessing Jacob's work, so he didn't want Jacob to leave. So he changed the roles a third time. This story is found in Genesis 30, starting at verse 27. Let's read some of it together. Laban said to him, "If I have pleased you, please stay. I know the Lord has blessed me because of you. Tell me what I should pay you. I will give it all to you." Jacob asked that he would be allowed to keep certain sheep for Laban's herd as payment. "Each of you have received your own herd of sheep. You have white sheep, speckled sheep, striped sheep, and black sheep. Turn your sheep over, then mix them up. I pretend to be Laban, you pretend to be Jacob." "Put all your sheep facing down, then flip them over." "Put all your sheep facing down, then flip them over one at a time. If you find a sheep that is speckled, you may keep that sheep. That will be your wages. I will give you time to find the speckled sheep." "See that you are getting far too many speckled sheep. Put all your sheep facing down again. But this time you could keep the sheep that are striped. That will be your wage instead. I will give you time to find all the striped sheep." "Seems like you have far too many striped sheep. Put all the sheep facing down again. This time you can only keep the black sheep. That will be your wages. That will be your wages instead. I will give you time to find the black sheep. Seems you have far too many black sheep. Put all the sheep facing down again. This time you can only keep one striped sheep, one spotted sheep, and one black sheep. That will be your wages instead. I will give you time to find one of each card. How's your sheep sorting going? It's hard to collect sheep when the rules keep changing. They even changed the rules of Jacob's wages, not once, not twice, not three times, but 10 times. Imagine how hard it must have been. It must have been to have been deceived that many times after working with all your might. God noticed what was happening, so he gave Jacob another dream. He instructed Jacob to return to his homeland, then reminded Jacob of the promise he had given him in Bethel. I will be with you, I will be your God, and you will be my people.
Jordan Jenkins.
The next part, Jacob's story, includes the great wrestling of all time. But before I tell you about Jacob's match, let's have one of our own. Each of you choose a partner. When I say go, lock fingers. Miss Janet and Sister Smock will show you. Like this. And try to dumb wrestle. We will time you for 35 seconds. We will set you for 35 seconds. Ready, set, go. Were any of you to pin your partners down? Were any of you wrestling with someone much bigger or smaller? What would it be like if you're wrestling like this all night long? Phew. Jacob's wrestling match was very different from yours because he was wrestling God himself. It happened when Jacob was on the move again. Now he was now on his way from Mizpah. At Luckel's Labbit's house, he had acquired great wealth, but he was still afraid. He was still afraid to face his past. Remember, he had lied to his brother and father, stealing his brother's blessing. When he last time saw Esau, his brother had been so angry Esau wanted to kill him. Jacob had planned while traveling. He sent scouts to see if his brother was near. They returned to tell him that Esau was going to meet him with 400 men. Jacob wanted to soften Esau's anger, so he sent a large gift of riches, camels, sheep, cows, moo, and donkeys, ping-pong, ahead to his brother. Then Jacob divided his family into two groups. He thought that if one of the group was captured, the other one could escape. Jacob stayed behind as night fell, and too, while he was alone, someone appeared and wrestled Jacob. Jacob wrestled with Jacob until morning. He even touched Jacob's head, made socket, and made a foul joint. Still, Jacob was still on. The man said, "Let me go." Jacob, who probably knew by now who was wrestling with the fly, "Not until you bless me." The man asked, "What is your name?" "Jacob." The man replied, "Your name shall no longer be Jacob, but Israel." In the morning, Jacob limped across the river and then moved to the front of the family and positioned. He was a changed man. Jacob met Esau first, before anyone else. Esau went to Jacob, they both wept, kissed, and hugged. Jacob and his family were finally restored. He was finally home. For the rest of his life, Jacob walked with the same lift, carried the name Israel with him as forever promised that he had wrestled with God and lived as if we receive a blessing.
Center you know very well, Amari Salmon, who's been up here many times before.
Good morning, church. Happy Sabbath. Before I start, please allow me to begin with a prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this wonderful, blessed day. Thank you for guiding, protecting us, keeping us safe. Help us to have a good rest of our day, and help Children's Church to go smoothly, and in your name, amen. After wrestling with God, Jacob was reminded of God's covenant promise. His family would be God's people, and he would be their God. He would always be with them. This promise went with them from generation to generation. First it was Abraham, then Isaac, then Jacob, and all of Jacob's children, grandchildren, and great-great-grandchildren. If you follow the full story of Jacob's family in the Bible, you'll find out that an entire nation came from him. They were named the nation of Israel, which also happened to be the same name God gave Jacob. But why is this important to us? Because we have inherited the same promise that Jacob and his family was given. God can be our God, and we can be his people. He will be with us and he will bless us in return. Do you remember the story of the ladder in Jacob's dream? Do you remember the story of, that ladder was meant to show how God would make a way for Jacob to be with him. What is it that connects us to God now? Maybe it's a paper airplane that could fly us around. How far could an airplane go? Maybe we need something more powerful. Probably a rocket. 3, 2, 1, blast off. Well, I don't think a rocket could take us all the way up to heaven. I think we would need something even more powerful than a ladder, more powerful than a plane, and more powerful than a rocket. Jesus died on a wooden cross shaped like this. Long ago, the cross was a punishment for the worst of criminals. But Jesus was no criminal. He chose to come live on earth to show us the truth. While he was here, he never once sinned, unlike us. Sin is what caused us to be separated from God. It is all that is evil and wrong in the world. The Bible tells us in Romans 6:23 that the wages of sin is death, but the gracious gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. When Jesus was on the cross, he took all of the world's sin upon himself so that we no longer have to be separated from God. He took the penalty of death for us. Can you believe that? For us. The Bible tells us in 1 John 1:9 that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and righteous, so that he will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. When we believe and accept that he died for our sins, we may always ask for forgiveness. God will be faithful in taking away those sins. When we believe and accept that he died for our sins, we may always ask for forgiveness. God will be faithful while taking away those sins. Jacob was not a perfect man. We saw that God's faithfulness was with him, and that he changed because of God's love. He lied and stole from his family, but God forgave him. He ran away all alone, but God was with him. He was cheated by his uncle, but God provided for him. He wrestled with his past, but God gave him a new name. Through it all, God's promise never faded. I will be with you wherever you go. I will be your God, and your people will follow me. That is the same promise of the cross. We are not perfect, but God is. We may sin, but God forgives us. There may be times where we are all alone, but God will be with us always. We may go through times where we are cheated by others, but we will provide for us. We may have made mistakes in our past, but God always gives us new life. God and Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. I wonder, friends and family, will you choose to say yes to Jesus? Will you be forever changed by God's faithfulness? Will you be given new life today and every day? Would you be willing to share his love? Have a great Sabbath.
Song, and then we'll have the pastor come up for a special blessing for the children.
We are climbing Jacob's ladder.
Please, don't sit. We're about to close. Sorry about that. I am going to invite all the children to come stand right here with me. All of you. You all come up. You're going to stand with me. Come on. Look at them. Beautiful children. If you're a parent, family member, I'm going to invite you to come and stand around us as close as you can. Hey, children, come as close as you can to me so we can give your parents a little space to stand with us. All right? All right. Look at your parents coming and your family members. All right. All right. All right.
That's all right. Your parents?
Yeah, you're good. You're good. Look at them coming. All right, children, guess what? We're now going to be very quiet. Very quiet. All right? Very quiet. Thank you. Thank you. And now we're going to bow our heads. We're going to close our eyes. And we're going to have a closing prayer where we talk to Jesus for a little bit. All right? Parents, touch your child, your children. Put your hands upon them. And I just ask all the members and friends in the audience, in the congregation, let's pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, thank you. Thank you for this beautiful Sabbath expression of our worship to you. Heavenly Father, today we received the blessings from heaven. As we see our children, Father, as they lead out this worship service in singing, as they led in praying, as they served us, Father, in giving to you, and also, Father, as we all received the word that came from them, knowing that you were the one who inspired them, and we have been blessed. And we just want to thank you and praise your name. We thank you for all our teachers, all those within our children's ministry department who worked with our children diligently and prepared them for this time. We just want to say thank you. We thank you for all the parents and family members and everyone who participated in nurturing our children and helping them, Father, to be able to do what they did today. Father, we just thank you for all of our parents and family members. We are here simply because we serve you. You're the God who created the human family. You're the God who loves us so much that you gave your only Son so that we might have eternal life. And so to you, we give all glory, all honor, and all praise. And now we ask, Father, that you will bless each and every person here in this sanctuary and those who are watching online with your heavenly presence and your love. And bless us with your forgiveness, Father. We receive it. And we just want to say our hearts are open for you to lead, guide, and bless us now and forevermore. We pray this in Jesus' name. Let the church of the living God say, amen, amen and amen.